Hello and welcome everybody. Slavery in Islam is one of the most important problems facing it in this era, because the norm and the tradition of the modern age do not allow this ethical practice. So in order to justify this immoral practice, Muslim preacher used the policy of throwing ash in the eye. Today's subject is a video made by channel Let the Quran Speak. The title of the video is Slavery in Islam, Sex Slavery and Concubine by Dr. Shabir Ali.
And one of those is about, you know, agency and ownership, and the fact that, you know, in the Islamic classical law, it seems like one can own a slave.
He asked about slavery in the Islam. It's like it's a suspicion and it does not exist in the Islam.
So can you talk to me about that a little bit?
Yeah, and this is rooted in the Quran itself. But to put that into perspective, it's important for us to, again, recapture.
Why you want to put this into perspective, you just need to talk about slavery in the Islam and the verses that talk about slavery and the authentic ahadith. That's all what she asked you about, to clarify if the slavery is exist in the Islam or not.
The overall approach of Islam to the question and the problem of slavery. At the time when the Quran was revealed, as we have surveyed among the world's ancient religions, well, the world's major religions, which mm-hmm. have ancient roots, we've seen that the religions generally do not condemn the institution of slavery as an institution on the whole.
So he say that since other religion allows slave trade, so there is no problem with trading in human in Islam. In this case, either God does not know the future and he is bound by the law and tradition of that time, or he does not exist and the Quran is a product of his environment.
But in various ways, various religions have tried to make amends to the difficulties that slaves were going through, and there are some accommodations.
And what does that have to do with the Islam and with God? In fact, Islam declare or say that he is the perfect religion that comes from God who created the universe. So he should be perfect in his laws and legislations, not following human beings and other false religions.
For a better life for slaves. But and of course, we've seen some very harsh rulings as well from some of the world's religions regarding how slaves might be treated.
Muslims always try to put the blame on other religions just to take attention away from their religion and scriptures.
With that background in mind, we should see that the Quran was actually bringing.
So is it must to put a background to a subject in order to address it? You just have to talk about the Islam and what he say about slavery.
About reforms in this whole institution. Mm-hmm. First of all,
the Quran is bring reform to this whole institution. Let us first agree on an important point here. Islam did not prohibit slavery, and the trade in human being did not stop until the last century. This means that this reform you are talking about that God bring is failed to implement this rule.
Reported to have forbidden for anyone to conduct a slave raid.
This is not true, because most of the prophet war were against his tribe and other disbeliever started by himself. It's only a handful of times when he was forced to defend himself in Ma'arakat al-Ahzab, when the unbeliever surrounded al-Madinah and other one. In fact, he used to send bandits from his companion to raid on the villages. And even if the Prophet does not say that he allowed it, the Quran is said it too in chapter 100 verses 3, launching raid at dawn. It's perfectly clear that the Quran is allowed and the Prophet most his war was against this believer started by himself.
One to conduct a slave raid. So you couldn't go raid a tribe, seize their people and make them slaves. Mm-hmm. So that by itself would dry up a major source of the increase of the slave.
That is not true, because when the Islam start, you know, there was a few slaves in the Saudi Arabia around Mecca and that area. By the time of Muhammad death and the first and the third Khalifa, they reached 100,000 slaves in that area.
slave population. And if the slave population is kept as it is, and eventually slaves are freed one after another, as stipulated in the Quran, then the slave population itself will dry up. The one
he said that the Quran allow freeing of the slaves in some cases. First of all the cases he talking about, you have other option, either to fast 2 months or to free a slave. It's depending on the case and is always optional. The second thing, let's agree on something here. The jihad, or the fighting in Islam, fighting the holy war, is the main source of the slave in the Islam. And if the jihad is going to stay up to the day of the judgment, then this means that the slaves will stay until the day of the judgment. They always going to be people be sold in the market, no matter what happened.
One avenue that remained was prisoners of war, because as we have already explained, the earliest Muslim community did not have a prison, a place to house the prisoners of war.
What the prison have to do with the slaves? And in other hand, you cannot justify owning a human being by telling there is no prison to put them, so we're going to enslave them.
And therefore, the prisoners of war were distributed within the society as domestic servants.
They're distributed as a slave, and a slave sex is a big difference in this.
Have their full legal right as a free person, but
no, they don't have a full legal right as a person. Even they get inherited if the person died. Here is a glimpse what the treatment of the slave and how the state this should be in the Islamic State. Ibn al-Mundir say, and whoever permitted the sale of the mother of the child, it must be said, if he did not sell it until he died and he have no heir expect her child, then she shall be freed from him. And if he has an heir beside her own child, her freedom price can be calculated from the inheritance of her son. So she set free, and he had what was left of his inheritance. And if there is nothing left, there is nothing for him. And if she worth more than his share, the amount of his share was set free from her, and the rest of it will be transferred to the rest of the inheritance, or of the rest of the heirs, except according to the saying of the one who said, if he inherit a share from one who will be freed, then the emancipation will be passed on to the rest of it. And if she did not have a child from her master, she get inherited by his inheritors, like the rest of the slaves. So we clear here not talking about human being or a human right for a person. So what is the difference here between your slave and your dog or donkey? Both you have to feed them and to give them proper place to stay in order to keep them healthy, so you can sell them after with a good price. That is the logic behind Muhammad saying what he's saying, not what you think.
The Quran stipulated the freeing of slaves for a number of transgressions, so as an atonement to seek forgiveness from God.
As I say, this Quran allowing slave is a myth, because always allowing slave in a very rare conditions, it's like you say Hitler was make a law to make a genocide on Jewish people and to burn them in a specific place made by the government, and he does not allow to do that other than this place. Quran and Hitler do the same thing here. It centralized or put a center to a place and make it legal and put the stamp of God on it. In fact, legalizing the practice make it legal to do so.
We would have to free a slave for this sin or for the other sin, and we all commit sins. Moreover, the Quran enjoined the freeing of slaves
So if you commit a sin, for example, if you eat in Ramadan, and in order God to forgive your sin, you have to buy a slave and to get it free to forgive your sin. In this case, it must have a market to sell people. Other than that, what is the mean of making this legislation?
And as a way of drawing closer to paradise for Muslims. And so if Muslims had followed all of these dictates altogether, eventually slavery would have become non-existent in Muslim societies.
1400 years of Muslims following their scripts, and the slaves seem always to increase, and the population of slaves always seem to increase. So what you're saying, there is no common ground or anything in the history of Islam supporting your claims.
And Muslims would have been the first to call for the abolition of slavery. Unfortunately, it didn't go that way due to the failings of Muslims.
Unfortunately, God does not know that human will come a day and they abolish slavery.
Not to any problem within the teaching of the religion.
Yeah, of course, it's not a problem with the teaching, but in the Quran, Sunnah full of laws that legislate to this trade and make laws and everything, make it legal and permitted to do so. So yes, there is no problem in the Islam, only people problem.
We should also acknowledge that the Quran left the matter somewhat open, in that one can still argue in a very traditional way today that since the Quran has left it open as a possibility that people could own slaves, well, who are we to cancel it altogether? We human beings have no say in what God has allowed.
That is perfectly reasonable, because all the verses and the tafsir and all the narration, authentic narration, and all the prophet companion and after his companion all do the same. So there is nothing to show us that Islam intention to free slaves.
However, there are many thinkers who now would look back at the Islamic tradition and say that when we recognize something to be wrong, as we do collectively as human beings now.
I wish to know which this thinker say so, but I don't think he's going to provide us with the name of these people who say that slavery is not in the Islam. Majority of people say they are kuffar and disbeliever. So the same thing, when you say this is not exist, people accuse you of disbelieving, and if you say that, you are the enemy of God.
We should not negate this advanced level of consciousness that we have developed by the grace of God. That too is a revelation from God, but in an indirect way. God has inspired human beings worldwide to come to this higher level of understanding.
So he said that is God, he's responsible for demolishing the slavery in the world. You know, it's so funny, because they always have to put God down there. No reason. If anything good happen in the world, is God who make it happen. If anything bad happen in the world, is ourself or our sin who do that. Same classical thinking.
We should now look back at our scriptures and see if there's any way that the scriptures can accommodate this new and advanced understanding. And I believe that the answer.
Same thing you do in the scientific miracle in the Quran. You're waiting for other scientists to found something, then you can claim that the Quran talked about it 1,400 years ago.
The answer to that is yes. And with that advanced understanding, we can go back to reinterpret some of the stipulations in the scripture and see how.
So can you tell me who's going to do this interpretation and who's allowed to do it and when?
Oh, those would apply in a modern and changing society.
So I'm going to ask you a hard question then. Let's talk
about. It's about 4 minutes in the video and still he does not give us a verse or anything that show in the Quran does not allow slavery or anything that show anything good about slavery in Islam.
About concubines, because
yeah, it's good you talking about concubines because you are a woman.
You know, Daesh, or you know, otherwise known as ISIS or Islamic State, comes and says, well, you know, capturing concubines in a time of war is acceptable. It's, you know, allowed in Islam. It's even a moral good. So how would you respond to that?
Well, definitely it's not a moral good. Everyone but Daesh would recognize that today. The Quran itself, you know, teaches us to repair wrongs, to remove harm, and
it's only they bring the verses that work in the wrong subject. She talking about slavery, women in the Islam, and if it's allowed under the Sharia law. You only have to answer yes or no.
The hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, La darra wa la dirar. There should be no harm.
Yeah, but that hadith is a single hadith, la darara wa la dirar. Does not mean anything, no harm, no. Can be explained in various way and does not have any edge you can catch it, or you're going to say he's talking about slavery. He's not talking about slavery, he's talking about something else.
Harming or reciprocating harm. So you shouldn't harm yourself or harm somebody else. And to take a free person and put them.
Yeah, you can't harm yourself or another person if he was a Muslim. If he wasn't means I'm Muslim is other case.
Into slavery, that's actually harming the person. And this is recognized in classical Islamic law. There's no doubt about it. Everybody would rather be free than to be a slave.
Yes, there is no doubt about it. If we're talking about same people, about Muslims in a community, but if we're talking outside the Muslim community, this is not recognizable. You just seen it for yourself because you're living in the West.
Slave. Mm-hmm. And so if you are taken from freedom and put into slavery, everybody recognizes this is just common sense. That person is.
I am happy you recognize this is common sense, that you take a person and you put it in slavery is harmful. That is common sense. This, I agree with you about this.
Is coming to some harm. That's how harm is defined in Islamic law. To give the person the freedom, this actually is repairing that harm or correcting that.
So you going to talk about the concubine or not? Because the time is passing and you're just wasting time.
Imbalance in society. So that's definitely wrong. But would we be reliving the original intention of the Islamic law by having slaves? No, because
Yes, the intention of the Islamic law to have slaves. There is too many verses talking about slave and talking about price of jihad, to go to fight for Allah. Your price is spoil, and spoil is always women's. Thank you guys for watching, and see you again for another video.